here with ACA Connects once again with another ACA Connects Zoom video, many of which we've been doing here during the COVID-19 crisis. And we have a special one here for you today with two very, very special guests where we're going to be talking about a discussion regarding the internet after COVID-19. Will we mind the gaps? Of course, the gaps of where the internet has been carried has been an issue during the COVID-19 crisis as we talk about spreading broadband all across the country. And we have two terrific guests here to talk about that today. First, we have Blair Levin, who's with us, a good friend of ours who I've known for some time. Blair right now is the non-resident senior fellow at the Brookings Institution, but he's also had many, many other positions in this broadband industry, government, as well as business throughout his career. Most notably, where I first had the chance to meet him when he was the executive director of the Omnibus Broadband Initiative at the Federal Communications Commission, which actually instituted the National Broadband Plan, which we'll talk about here a little bit later. We're here with also with Blair Larry Downs, who is the project director for the Georgetown Center for Business and Public Policy. He's been a senior fellow with Accenture and also a fellow for the Center for Internet and Society at Stanford Law School. So before we begin, thank you both for being here, and we appreciate you joining our ACA Connect Zoom.
It's great to be here. Great to see you.
So we are going to talk about the internet after COVID-19 and will we mind the gaps? But as we do this, I wanted to highlight why we're doing this. The fact of the matter is that you have written an article, you've both written an article for the Aspen Institute, but not just that, but your thoughts on this issue of minding the gap, so to speak, have appeared in a number of places, which we'll post with this video once we proceed after we're done here today. So the first article is, of course, what I just referenced, the internet after COVID-19, will we mind the gaps, for the Aspen Institute. You've also written for The Hill, a title of a story called Keeping Americans Connected after the Keep Americans Connected pledge expires. You've also written an article for the Brookings Institution, COVID-19 shows that America's broadband plan is still in beta, very interesting title. And Larry, you have an article that's coming from the MIT Sloan Management Review soon called Five Things Every Manager Must Do to Manage Disruption in the COVID-19 Era, much of which we'll talk about today. So we're here to talk about really a postmortem, I guess you could say, of the COVID-19 crisis and how broadband providers have done, as well as where those gaps exist regarding digital infrastructure, et cetera. But tell me what really first it urged you to consider this topic and maybe to write about it. And Blair, I'll start with you.
Well, thank you very much. And again, Matt, thank you for having us today. What really struck me was 10 years ago, when we were writing the National Broadband Plan, there were a group of us who thought that broadband was really essential. We had to get networks everywhere. We had to get everybody on them. And that we had to utilize them better to assure that economic growth continued and that social progress would be achieved. We did not have a political consensus at that time. And we were also under significant constraints because we wrote it post the Recovery Act. And therefore, as the White House said, be bold and be creative, but just don't ask for any money. And it struck me that as COVID started to hit, number one, you had a political consensus that was now similar to the group that we worked with. Everyone now seems to agree. We need networks everywhere. We need everybody on them. And also, we are in what the CEO of Microsoft referred to as the remote everywhere world. And in that world, it seemed to me that we should once again take up the mantle of actually evaluating where the gaps are, but also where the opportunity is. And also, while Congress is in a mood to spend money, that there are certain parts of our ecosystem that both in terms of policy, but also in terms of practical politics, it would be good to put some money into filling those gaps. So that's what inspired me to do it.
Larry, how about you?
Well, I first started working with Blair soon after the publication of the National Broadband Plan, which I wasn't involved in, so I can praise it all I want without seeming immodest. And I thought it was a visionary document. I was very impressed with it, and I really wanted to help evangelize a lot of the ideas, which I've been doing with and without Blair off and on for the decade since its publication. So in the case of this particular paper, as is often the case, Blair wrote to me and said, let's do a piece, and it started from there.
Well, that's great. And again, it's great to have you today. And as we dig into some of the questions that we'll cover throughout the next hour or so, Blair, for the pieces that you and Larry have written, you've pretty much come at things more from the broadband side of the equation, especially in light of your leadership with the 2010 National Broadband Plan. And Larry, you focused a bit more on how business and government have performed, as well as other industries when we talk about digital infrastructure. And we'll explore both of those topics as we go forward. But maybe to level set, particularly for our ACA Connects members who are listening or who will be seeing this afterwards, it's a good story that I think, and a good foundation where we can start, knowing that as we look at the context of where broadband is today, particularly in light of the COVID-19 crisis, we've seen that it's a very good news story. And it's a very good story in general, that as the crisis came upon us in general, broadband networks actually met the need, as did our members at ACA Connects, because of the ability that they had to invest and innovate and deploy broadband in their very remote and hard to reach areas. So despite the fact that it's not 100% and there are gaps, which we're going to talk about, it's a very good story about how our members stepped up not only to meet the FCC's pledge, but really in many ways went above and beyond that, not only related to late fees and disconnections, none of those, but creating new Wi-Fi hotspots, et cetera. But as you point out, you know, there are some gaps that we need to take a look at, and we need to study here now as we look back at this crisis and be better as an industry, as a government, as businesses and consumers going forward. So with that strong foundation to build with, Blair, let me start with you, because in the nature of your articles here, you've really characterized broadband and what we've seen as sort of going through a broadband stress test, which you've characterized the COVID-19 emergency for many domestic systems, including not only broadband networks, but also digital infrastructure. So basic question, how do you think these networks have performed?
So I'm going to give you an answer that no one in DC ever gives, which is, I don't really know. And part of the reason for doing the study is to come to that understanding. Now, what is true for anybody studying something, you always start with an opening hypothesis, right? And my hypothesis would be they perform pretty well. In fact, I suspect they perform very, very well. Read a study today that suggested that in a study of 116 countries, the United States may have performed the best of any. That may be true, and I suspect the industry would actually benefit from having a third party take a look at that. One of the reasons I think the industry performed so well is that there's been a huge increase in download speeds. When we did the National Broadband Plan, the average speed was 4.1 megs down. Now it's close to 140. So that's, you know, that laid the foundation for performing well. But I think that's, it would be good for the country to study, and I think there are certain areas, particularly where the telco is doing DSL, that may have not performed as well. There are other gaps, as we identify. There's coverage gaps.
That's what I was going to ask you next. Where are the gaps?
Yeah, so I think beyond the performance thing, which I'm not sure there was a gap, but I think is worth studying, and there have been some reports of some gaps. There are four other ones we identify. First is coverage. This has gotten the most press. Digital divide is now a term that lots of people are using. So where do we have a divide in terms of where networks don't exist that are capable of delivering at least a minimum baseline speed? And secondly, gaps because a coverage gap because people aren't on it, the adoption, so-called adoption gap. Then we have the utilization gap. And I think to me, this is maybe the biggest one. I'm a little counter the normal thinking here, but we're doing a lot. We're just not doing it well. We're not utilizing it fully. Plus, there's huge IT problems in the federal government as well as in the state and local government. You see this with unemployment offices, where the IT infrastructure, the combination of hardware and software, isn't delivering all that it could. Larry knows a lot more about that than me, but I think that's a key point. There were also security gaps. We saw that in Zoom. Hopefully, we won't be Zoom bombed on this one. But there's, I think, a very important question of what are the things that really require some kind of public standard if you're dealing with education, you're dealing with healthcare. Businesses probably should be able to take care of themselves, almost certainly should be able to take care of themselves. But what's the right role of government in assuring security? And then finally, we identify the information gap. This is a tricky one. I think there should clearly, it's pretty easy, I think, to set forth an agenda talking about how government should make more valuable information more readily available. We could chat about what I, some specifics on that, but particularly early on in the crisis, it was difficult to find certain, I think, important information. But also there was a lot of negative, untruthful medical information. And I'm not sure, I don't know what to do about that, but I think that deserves a very robust public discussion so that people have a better chance of getting the truth than relying on just completely made up false information about their health.
Well, Larry, you've been a bit more critical about the performance of the digital infrastructure on the service industries, such as health, education, financial services, energy, where there's limited competition in incumbents in heavily regulated industries and of government. So as you look back here over the last couple of months, what went wrong and what's needed?
Yeah, I mean, these are old and very deep problems. And the irony is that, again, the National Broadband Plan, the whole second half of it, looked at these areas and said, these are the real potential areas for using digital infrastructure to improve outcomes, to improve the economy, to improve livelihood, and so on. And much of it wasn't done. And as I have argued elsewhere, a lot of that is because there is limited competition. So for example, you know, you look at financial services industry, the SBA was tasked with these loan programs that were supposed to get money into the hands of small businesses right away to keep them afloat. And their IT infrastructure just couldn't handle it. They weren't able to take applications. They weren't able to process application. And at the same time, you had these financial tech startups, these fintech companies, people like Cabbage and PayPal and others, who had the infrastructure. They were ready to do it, but they weren't authorized by the SBA to take applications because they weren't traditional banks. That I think is sort of indicative of the problem and of the solution. So what's going to happen here, and we've seen this in every industry to some extent, the less regulated industries, it happens sooner, the more regulated industries, it happens later, is the technology is there to radically transform these industries, to make them more user accessible, make them more customer friendly. The regulation that's supposed to be protecting consumers in these industries is actually what's keeping these new initiatives, these new ideas out. But eventually, you know, you look at transportation and what happened, or with Uber and Lyft, or with the hospitality, with Airbnb, eventually the technology just breaks through and the regulations kind of fall away. It's not clean, it's not pretty, it's never as fast or as efficient as you want. But I think in a lot of these industries that have now been exposed, badly exposed, as having underinvested in their IT infrastructure, you're going to see startups now become much more aggressive about pushing through the regs, pushing through these barriers, and giving consumers what they want and what they could, in fact, already have.
So you've talked about industry. Now let's talk about government. What's your take on how the administration, Congress, the FCC so far have handled this crisis in terms of connectivity and digital infrastructure issues?
Yeah, Blair, go first on that.
Yeah, I'll go first.
Go ahead, Larry. Sorry.
Yeah, I having been in government a couple times, I always, I'm a little reluctant to grade people inside government because it's difficult to know all the different pressures they were under. So, you know, starting with the White House, I'll simply say that it reinforced, I recently read a great book by a conservative political thinker, Yuval Levin, no relation, who talks about part of the problem of government is we have institutions that now are only interested in what he calls performative government, government as an art of performance, as opposed to actually doing things. And I think when you look at the White House, it was all about performance, whether it was announcing that Google website that never really existed or AirBridge flying things around that, you know, has been abandoned. And they kept saying things, but they weren't really coordinating or doing things. I think that the FCC, I give Ajit credit for thinking very quickly and clearly about the Keep America Connected initiative, which I know a lot of your members participated in. I do think there was a kind of a a problem with that, which was it was a 60-day solution to a problem that's going to last a lot longer than 60 days. And one of the things that Larry and I did and was to write an op-ed in support of what the House COVID bill did to give broadband vouchers, which would essentially solve that problem over a longer period of time. But I don't think, frankly, it's going to pass. So that's a bit of a problem, but I think the FCC was trying. I probably would have focused a bit more in addition on making sure that the kids who were trying to do classwork at home had more access to broadband, some kind of program to do that, whether it be with an E-rate or Lifeline or some other FCC ability. I think the governors and a lot of local people did really a masterful job. And I just have to say, I think the American public did a really great job. It is astonishing how quickly people sheltered in place. Mm-hmm. And that clearly saved a really huge number of lives. And that was a voluntary action very early on. But I do think we should again understand the role that technology played in that. If we had had the broadband infrastructure we had 10 years ago, we would have had a very different picture. But that also tells us something about how we have to look forward, because we now have a very significant portion of the population that is getting used to this notion of working at home. But there are divides that we have in this society that we really can't allow to fester in terms of what it means to be a worker whose physical presence is required and what it means to be a worker who's not. So I think there are a lot of issues. But I don't want to give A, Bs, and Cs because I'm not sure it's that many.
That's quite all right. And fortunately, we have the time to drill down on a few. So Larry, what's your take on how governments performed? And by the way, Blair, just one thing to comment on, and this is interesting for our discussion, because in some ways you talked about the crisis in past tense, but it really isn't, because there's still exactly so right. much to that we have to deal with going forward. So we'll keep it in that context as well, which is the fact that we still have problems to solve. So Larry, what's your take on how government has performed so far?
Yeah, well, so obviously, you know, in terms of customer service, in terms of service to constituents, terrible. The answer is terrible. As Blair mentioned, you know, the unemployment services, health services, any sort of application where users needed to interact with a government application, what we found was, again, massive underinvestment in IT infrastructure. They couldn't handle the volume. They couldn't handle the adapting to new requirements. They couldn't handle the new programs. They just couldn't handle it. I think also in terms of broadband specifically, to talk about Congress, what was interesting to me is that, you know, where we had so many industries that were getting bailouts, which they desperately needed, certainly in, you know, travel and so on, where they were literally shut down. We didn't see that for the broadband industry. We saw the exact opposite. We saw, as Blair mentioned, the FCC asking for the pledge, which your members and others responded to in fact make financial sacrifices, to you know, not charge late fees, to not cut off non-paying customers during this crisis, and the industry responded. But it's interesting to me that the one sort of industry where we were really relying on the most was not getting support. In fact, it was asking for more help. And in some ways, it's a testimony to how the industry has, built ahead of demand, invested in infrastructure over the last 10 years in particular. We were able to meet that demand. So there was no apparent crisis as there was in financial services and transportation and hospitality and so on. And so, of course, you know, Congress said, well, there's no crisis. So not only aren't we going to give them more support, we're going to ask them for help. And as Blair and I said in our most recent piece, that was great and it worked, but it's not a long-term solution. And in fact, as public companies, in many cases, it just can't go on indefinitely. And so we do need a more long-term result.
Well, let's get into a little bit of the details of your proposal. And Blair, I'm going to come back to you, and we're going to go back 10 years before we fast forward to the present again. So you both have proposed an initiative that would combine the best of the admirable 9/11 Commission report and the 2010 National Broadband Plan. But before, you know, getting into the specifics of that proposal, Blair, I want to ask you about you know, your experience leading the National Broadband Plan, which, as I said, where we had first had the chance to meet. What do you feel like you got right, and maybe, you know, what didn't happen as well as you would have liked in the original plan?
Well, I've actually given some talks and speeches and gone into details of this, but I'll try to do it quickly. We did a few things I'm really proud of. I think we did a great job on spectrum, laid out a spectrum plan, did the incentive auctions, which were, I think, really important. I think we got the first responder network roughly right. In fact, the only legislation that's occurred in the last 10 years in telecom kind of came out of the National Broadband Plan. I want to be clear about something. We also understood our role. I would never say that I did anything. I would say I was part of a team. Right. And I think our team kind of moved the ball. We didn't invent most of these ideas that we had and pushed. We moved the ball from like our 20-yard line down to about the 20-yard line, mm-hmm. and others in Congress and the FCC got it across. They might say we got it from, you know, the other team's 20 to the 30. But, you know, you could argue about that. But the point is, it's a team effort. And what the plan tried to do was, A, generate good ideas with some level of detail, and B, bring a lot of political capital to them. Mm-hmm. We also did some things that resulted in private initiatives. Google Fiber grew out of our work, Comcast Internet Essentials. I think that was that was good. We also helped lay the foundation for how the FCC would move from supporting voice to supporting broadband and universal service, moving to reverse auctions for that support. So there were a lot of details in that. There were certainly some things that I think about. I wish we had done more about the role of devices in the ecosystem. I wish we had done stuff on privacy, which is clearly a big issue. But maybe the thing I'm most proud of is we saw it as part of a process. And indeed, the beginning of the implementation chapter begins, this plan is in beta and always will be. Yeah. And I really had kind of hoped we'd do it every 5 years. As Larry mentioned, probably my biggest disappointment is the last half of the book, the last 200 pages, which is half of it, talks about how we can improve society by using broadband better. That really wasn't implemented that well. I would like to see a new effort to do that. I think the time is right to do that. But it's also, and you've alluded to this, and Larry's alluded to it, in 2010, the networks were behind the demand. But now the networks are actually ahead. You can actually, pretty much human creativity hasn't yet caught up. This may change with augmented reality and virtual reality. But right now, the network is not suppressing any kind of application that's generally used. So I think it's a great time to rethink, you know, how do we deliver better healthcare? How do we deliver better education? A really important thing, how do we deliver better job training? Right. Because people are going to have to continually retrain in different kinds of jobs. Great opportunities, but we really need a unified national effort to get it done.
Also shows just how difficult it is in Washington to actually move that ball across the goal line, and how it does take years with a solid team and a solid set of ideas to help start that discussion. So absolutely. So let's just go to the next step then, Blair. Tell us about what you're proposing in your initiative, and then Larry, we'll come to you next.
Yeah, I mean, I think there are lots of different ways to do it. What I'd love to see, frankly, is some private effort that does what, in a way, the 9/11 Commission did by being bipartisan and having a certain kind of leadership that everybody kind of respects, that doesn't read things through a partisan narrative, but is rather very data-driven. And I'd like to see that start relatively soon and get done after the election, but very quickly after the election. And the reason for that is, whether Trump is reelected or Biden is elected, there are going to be teams that are thinking about either what's the big agenda for the beginning of the second term, or what's the agenda for the first term. And that's where you really want to influence things. So I think there's a big, what I think of as a kind of a technology broadband ecosystem agenda. I'd like to get that, not as we did with the National Broadband Plan a year and a half after the inauguration, but have it done before then so it can really feed into a lot of different initiatives. So that would be my image of it. there's a different way of doing it, which is what Ed Markey has proposed, and I support his legislation as well, which is you simply have the FCC redo the National Broadband Plan, but do it with consciousness of what COVID may have revealed. So his legislation actually is very similar to the article that Larry and I wrote in terms of substance. And that would be a perfectly fine.
Not a coincidence.
Not a coincidence. A third way of doing it, frankly, is what Governor Cuomo announced a couple of weeks ago, which is that Eric Schmidt, formerly of Google, is going to head a 15-person commission that will be looking into reimagining New York. And when you listen to what Eric talked about in terms of making sure we have broadband everywhere and how do we use it for purposes of healthcare and education, well, that's very similar. And I suspect that just as Cuomo has influenced a lot of other governors, the Cuomo-Schmidt initiative is going to have a big influence on the way people think. They're both very smart, creative, politically savvy people, and that would be another way to do it. So, you know, there's pros and cons of all these things, but I would say right now, Cuomo and Schmidt have the lead.
So Larry, as we think about implementing your ideas and the notion of taking this concept of a national broadband plan and really rethinking it on a regular and ongoing basis, which makes so much sense because so much has developed in 10 years since you and your team started this, Blair. You know, as we look at the White House, Congress, other federal agencies, the FCC, you know, all with various kinds of processes and procedures to implement things like this, we're talking a challenge, particularly in light of the fact that 10 years now into the future from where you've started, Blair, you know, things are so much more politically divided. We are so divided in terms of our policy application, et cetera. So, Larry, in this environment, then, what would be needed across the White House, the FCC, other federal agencies, Congress, to actually take something like this and ultimately get it to be a final product?
Yeah, and I would add, certainly as Blair already hinted, at the states as well, particularly right. You know, some of the key states, which do a lot of their own investing in broadband programs, particularly here in California. Well, what's really needed is speed. That's what's going to separate success from failure. The military has a term they call after action review. So, you know, after some kind of action, they do a quick review. You know, it's very candid, memory is fresh of what happened, what went right, what went wrong. And then, you know, they take as tactical action to correct any problems for future things. That's really what we need here. And it's obviously not as likely to happen if it's done as a public effort, if it's done through the FCC or through the states or, you know, through Congress. Even the 9/11 Commission was delayed a good solid year with a lot of, you know, political wrangling. So I think it would work much better as a private initiative. That way it could be done quickly when the data is fresh in our minds, when the urgency is still quite there. And I think that's the most likely time where we would get sort of real recommendations that were implementable, that weren't kind of bogged down with politics, that were really sort of, you know, still with the spirit of cooperation that we've had during the crisis as it's unfolded so far. And we'll have to see, you know, obviously if you don't do the one, you're going to do the other. So one way or the other, there's going to be an assessment. One way or the other, there's going to be recommendations. They may come too late. They may come with a lot of baggage, or they may be like a military after action review, quick and strategic.
And Matt, if I could just add,
sure, Blair.
It certainly is true that DC is a lot more polarized than it was 10 years ago. And in our space, you know, I have some fondness being chief of staff at the FCC when we had to implement the 96 Telecom Act, which passed with huge majorities of both the House and the Senate. And we implemented it on I think almost every major vote was unanimous. There were a lot of compromises. I mean, politics was hard, but there was a spirit where people didn't think it was a bad thing to compromise, and we're in a difficult environment now. Having said that, however, if you look at the agenda that Larry and I put forward, it doesn't include the words net neutrality, Title I, Title II.
Right.
We could argue about that. We will argue about that. That's still in the courts and still, you know, in Congress. But that's not really relevant to the agenda we're talking about. There's some very complicated issues with competition that need to be debated, but I don't think those are relevant. And if you take those two things off the table and you simply ask, do you agree that we should get networks everywhere? Do you agree we should get everyone on? Do you agree we should utilize them better? You really get 80, 90% consensus. There are always some anti-tech people, but you get a consensus on the goal. And if you, I think, do it well, you'll argue about the tactical stuff. But there's actually a lot, and Larry and I have talked to lots of people about this, there's a lot of tactical agreement. Mm-hmm. And so I think part of what we're seeing is there's actually a political opportunity that in light of all the different polarization, other people may miss. But on these issues, I do think that there could be a very interesting consensus that could unite a lot of people and really drive a very, frankly, I don't think a very helpful partisan agenda for one side or the other, but I do think a very helpful policy agenda that simply results in better outcomes in the next 5 to 10 years.
I agree with you on behalf of the organization that I represent and our members. I mean, we are problem solvers. We're trying to meet the needs of our customers and communities. We're so thankful that we had the opportunity to, as I said before, invest and innovate in deploying broadband to meet this need today. And it's not a political issue. I mean, it is an implementation issue, and we have to figure out together how we can do that, regardless of policy or politic, but really focused on the needs of the community. So we certainly support your efforts there. Blair, I wanted to stay with you because you mentioned something at the outset that I wanted to give you a chance to talk about as well, and that's privacy and security as we go forward. Certainly, you know, any update to the national broadband plan would, you know, have to reflect on these issues. While, you know, the upside of using broadband is certainly greater because there's much more opportunity and there are so many more things available to consumers, communities, businesses, et cetera. There's also a downside, particularly today in light of COVID, when we're talking about tracing and apps that follow you around. In fact, here in Pittsburgh, where I'm from, there's an app developer that's putting together one of the apps for COVID tracing. So how do you harmonize some of these privacy and security concerns that are real issues with the need to not only implement your plan, but also, you know, think about how we move forward with broadband and digital infrastructure in a post-COVID era?
Yeah. So I'll start by saying, what are the differences between doing a broadband plan in 2021 and doing one, or 2020 and doing one in 2010, is that when we did it in 2010, there was a general view that tech was awesome. And therefore, it was just like, how do you do more? And what you see in our plan, there was an awful lot of incentives to do rather than constraints on doing. And I think that realistically, anyone trying to do a similar thing now would end up having more constraints. And I'm not saying constraints on deploying networks. I'm just saying constraints on utilization of data and constraints in terms of minimum security requirements or whatever. I don't know the answer to those things, frankly. I do think it would be very valuable for society to have a good internal debate in which people are not looking to cameras. It's a little bit of, again, you know, what I referred to earlier is in terms of performative government. The broadband plan had a lot of public input, but we didn't do a lot of performative stuff. We didn't do, Twitter wasn't as big a deal in those days. And so I guess what I would say is you are not going to have broad levels of use, which you need for economic growth and for social progress, unless you have some kind of baseline minimum in terms of privacy protections and security protections. And so I think that's what you want to get at. And then you may want to do more than that. But look, we should be studying what the EU did and its impact, and we should be studying what happened during COVID. And that's really kind of the purpose. Larry knows a lot about a lot of stuff that I don't, and he may have some answers that I don't, but I come to it from the perspective of, this is more about what does society need to solve and how do we have a process to solve it than actually having an answer.
Larry, same question.
Yeah, but look, certainly on the security standpoint, again, you know, all that the pandemic has done in some respects is to accelerate by a few years what was happening anyway. We already knew that many industries, again, had done an extremely poor job of implementing just basic, both physical and digital security in their networks and in their, you know, physical access to the equipment itself. They don't follow basic protocols. They don't, you know, adopt the IEEE security standards. And it keeps coming back to bite us. It's one of the main things I think that's held back, for example, adoption of the Internet of Things, is you had so many device manufacturers, you know, releasing products in a hurry because that's what you do. But then, you know, the passwords were set to password or to admin or something. And of course, you had all these embarrassing moments where you know, people got access to video streams from kids' toys. And, you know, they're not exactly fatal mistakes, but they're bad PR and they've set the industry back. And I don't think it's just limited to these sort of startups in the IoT. I think it's true, again, even for very important industries like financial services, like energy, they just haven't done a good job. It has not been a priority, even when there are breaches, even when there are these embarrassing hacks, we sort of, you know, go back to business as usual. So I think, again, the more we're relying on broadband to do literally everything, the more these things are going to come up. And whether it's through kind of consumer pressure or whether it's through actual legislation or regulation, there's so much we could already be doing to improve the security of this equipment and of the networks that we're not. That, you know, we don't have to get into science fiction in terms of this to get sort of, you know, an 80% improvement rather than a, you know, a 20% of the really hard cases.
I do like the concept, going back to something we started at the very beginning talking about, a broadband stress test, because certainly as we look at COVID-19 and our digital infrastructure, there's no doubt that a lot of pressure has been placed upon the broadband business model going forward, not only for companies like ACA Connect members as internet service providers, but a lot of other companies that, and industries that use digital infrastructure. And, you know, this is going to be not just a short-term or a mid-term problem, but really a long-term problem, as we were alluding to before. COVID-19 hasn't ended, but we're entering a new normal where this is going to be part of our lives and how we deal with it. So Larry, as you think about this in terms of the impact and the pressure on broadband providers as well as others in digital industries, you know, what should broadband video voice providers like those of our ACA Connects members be thinking about in terms of positioning themselves for the new future?
Sure. So, yeah, one of the things I think that we've really, again, seen in this pandemic, we've seen it a lot over the last 20 years, but one of the things we're really seeing is that future arrives a lot sooner than you think it's going
sure
to.
Did.
And so we have this whole category in my most recent book, you know, we have this whole category of technologies we refer to as emerging technologies, things like artificial intelligence and quantum computing and so on. It's like, you know what, there's no more emerging technology. They've all emerged. It turns out that these things were already mature enough to be put into use. It was a question of requirements, it's a question of need. And now when we suddenly had these intense new requirements, both in terms of capacity and in terms of applications, what a surprise, those technologies are ready to go. So I think, you know, my main recommendation or message to your members, as to any company, but particularly to technology companies, is don't sort of put off those emerging technologies. Don't imagine that they're not relevant to your business today. Don't imagine that you can wait to find out about them, to experiment with them, to invest in them, to acquire startups that are using them. Because you'll find out that tomorrow they show up and customers are either going to use them or demand to use them. And so I think, you know, as you think about your investment in technology, number one is remove the label emerging, because it's a crutch that keeps you from actually doing anything with it. Imagine that it's already emerged. And the question now is, what are you going to do with it? And what are you going to do if your competitors do something with it before you do? I think that would take us a long way. And it doesn't have to be, you know, we're not talking about major new investments or major, well, it can be, but it doesn't have to be major new initiatives or investments. It can just be sort of speeding up what you were already doing and also kind of pushing the time horizon further out, recognizing that, you know, items in your rearview mirror may be much closer than you think.
Well, and if I can add to that,
sure, please.
Larry wrote, co-authored a great book, which I had nothing to do with it, so I can praise it, called Pivot to the Future.
Yes.
And it just lots of examples of how businesses did it well and didn't do it well. And it just struck me as I'm reading it that it's something that government doesn't do well. And there's lots of different reasons for that. There's structural reasons, institutional reasons, there's some personal reasons. But, you know, at the heart of what Larry and I are doing, which kind of combines experiences with businesses as well as with government and politics, it is a call to pivot to the future. COVID has shown us that we are moving toward this, again, kind of remote everything future. Not that that will be 100%, but it goes from being 5% of the economy to 40% of the economy, eventually to 60%. And we need to pivot to that. And there's a great opportunity there, but if we don't do certain things, we will both be screwing up our society and falling behind where we should be.
And to that point, Blair, I want to read a portion of the article that Larry just wrote for the MIT Sloan Management article. And I want Larry to comment on this afterwards, because I think it speaks to this and how consumers are migrating and evolving too. And Larry, you wrote in your article, customers forced to solve their own sales, delivery, and service problems in the last few months are learning fast just how much benefit they bring to every transaction. Don't expect them to forget that when the crisis is over. Instead, give them the tools to do even more and watch the trapped value you share with them multiply. So what would be your suggestions on how our ACA Connects members as internet service providers and others can actually meet that?
Sure. So look, I mean, again, this is really an acceleration of trends that have already been in place, but clearly, self-service is the way to go. Now we sort of have to do it for terms of physical safety. And, you know, your industry's done a great job of making it easier to do self-service or there's, you know, virtually assisted self-service. And the number one thing is do more of that. Give customers even more tools to configure, to problem solve, to sort of, you know, do their own marketing effectively, do their own sales, do their own support, do their own installation. And of course, you know, what the value to companies, to your companies are, is you're gonna collect a lot of information. If you're paying attention, you're gonna see, hey, these are the things that are the most frequently misunderstood, or these are the things that people want that we didn't necessarily realize they wanted or give them the opportunity to buy or to do or to say. So your job is really to give them the tools, collect the information, and then as you value that information, as you use it to improve your efficiency or to your offerings or to your service, whatever it is you get value from that information, from those interactions, you've got to give some back. You've got to share it with them, and you have to make that explicit. You say, look, you know, I know, again, there's still banks that will charge you for doing online bill pay because, you know, this makes no sense at all. They're saving money by having you do it, but they're going to charge you for that service. So it just ruins the incentives for doing it. And it just looks like they don't understand what's going on. So you can't do that. If there are genuine savings, then you've got to figure out ways to share them and make it clear that the customers understand, if you do more of this and let us pay attention to it and let us learn from it, then we'll both benefit. And here's tangibly what those benefits look like. Again, we've seen this in a lot of industries. We've seen it in the broadband industry. We're just going to see more of it, and it's going to happen faster.
Blair, I want to come back to you again on the importance of broadband. And you've said this in a number of your answers, but I want you to answer this specifically. As we look back at COVID-19 here, at least the last few months, the fact that broadband providers very early on in the crisis were asked and even expected to provide service, continued service, without expectation of payment in the normal course, not to charge late fees to customers who are experiencing financial problems due to COVID-19, but other services, other industries, even when we talk about important things such as food, gas, other things, were not expected to really meet the same kinds of needs. And I'm not saying that, you know, critically one way or the other, but what my question is, what does that say to you just about the nature of where broadband fits in general now in our world and in our country?
So was that for Larry or for me?
That's for you, Blair.
Okay. well, I think I think broadband is an essential service. And you know, I remember 10 years ago talking to some executives in your industry and saying, "Congratulations, you know, like you're really essential." Congratulations. This also probably means government cares a lot more, right? I mean, doesn't government doesn't care if all you're doing is delivering HBO. I mean, they mildly are interested. And certainly, I mean, this we saw this in the 92 Cable Act, right? To go back to the dark history of
I was there.
Regulation. And I, you were there. I wasn't there at the time, but shortly thereafter arrived and was charged with implementing what was a difficult task. But it was only because the cable, it wasn't about HBO, it was about all those other programs like CNN and some others that people began to see as essential. So I think there is a sense that it's absolutely essential now. And that's great. And by the way, when you look, I do some Wall Street stuff. Cable's doing fantastically well. There are a lot of people who thought they could survive just on wireless who are now adding cable, even though they have of money. And by the way, one of the things that worries me about the Connect America initiative is not just that it's going to end on June 30th, but then the government assistance to a lot of unemployed people is going to end on July 31st. So whereas I think the numbers are pretty good today, the bad debts and the unpaid bills, they're going to get a lot worse in August, unless we have a V recovery, which I don't anticipate. But for the industry, it just means that the government's going to want a lot more from you. And one of the things that also kind of in the weeds drove me and Larry to write the piece we wrote was, as we get to an understanding that we need to get networks everywhere, we have to ask, well, then how are you going to pay for them? We pay for universal service today through something called the contribution factor. All of your members know this because all of your members, you're essentially collecting a tax on behalf of the government, and that raises your bills. That's it's largely a capital expense being paid for as an operating expense by a tax on a revenue base that is going down. And that's a recipe for disaster. I think we need to clean that up soon, which is another reason why we need to bring a detailed plan with political capital to the government as soon as possible. But you know, the short answer to your question is, it's a two-edged sword. You're totally essential, and therefore the government wants more out of you than ever.
Well, and let's follow up on that. And this is for both of you as well. In what you've written, and Blair, you mentioned this a little bit earlier. You think vouchers for consumers are perhaps a good idea on how they could afford not only broadband but other important services that they might need, cell phone service, et cetera. But at the same time, you also talk about, just to your point, Blair, how we and how the government really acts and intervenes to help consumers and ISPs to continue to keep them connected. Two really different things when you talk about vouchers and more direct government support. So how do you see this rolling out and what would be, you know, your preferred route? And Larry, we'll start with you.
Yeah, so I think Blair can talk to the political realities of getting anything done here. But yeah, well, obviously, we have some really good programs in place. We have Lifeline. We have, you know, what used to be called the high cost for build out now, all the various rural programs. And in some ways, we just need to do more of that. And particularly in the case of Lifeline, we need to find a sustainable funding source, because as Blair mentioned, the contribution factor it's been a ticking time bomb for years. It's a bomb that, you know, will go off. It will go off soon. So, you know, sort of funding Lifeline, funding these other build out initiatives is very important. But then I think we also have to look at sort of some of the root causes of non-adoption, and this gets to some fairly controversial stuff. But one of the interesting things about the proposed legislation was it also included device support. So a lot of people, you know, who could qualify for Lifeline or for low-cost programs from their broadband provider, don't adopt anyway. And one of the reasons is they don't have a computer. They don't know how to use a computer. They don't know how to turn on a computer. So there's you know, the lack of device, there's lack of what you might call digital literacy. These are still real issues in some of the demographics that are particularly high in the disconnected camp. And I'm thinking particularly of seniors. Blair and I are approaching that category, so we appreciate their problems all the more. Obviously, those with the lower education levels, in some cases, rural citizens. And so, you know, I don't know if we're going to get these reforms, but what we need are reforms that look really much more broadly and much more specifically at who's not connected and why. Is it because of availability? Is it because of cost? Is it because of device? Is it because of digital literacy? Is it because of other cultural barriers? And what does it need to take to get them online? Because we need them. They need it clearly, but we need them as well. We really want to have a robust digital conversation in all respects, and that requires closing what remains of these now much more specific gaps.
Blair?
No, I have nothing to add to that. I think that kind of sums it up.
Well, then let me step back and maybe take ask you to address a bigger question. Blair, you refer to it, the fight over net neutrality that's been back and forth with both sides, more regulation, less regulation, et cetera. And, you know, certainly industry has a view, policymakers have a view, consumer groups have a view. But there's also been talk from time to time on a bipartisan basis for the potential or at least maybe the interest in broader broadband legislation that could really try to solve some of these problems that really allow us to get beyond kind of the argument and to say, okay, let's roll up our sleeves and get to work. And certainly an organization like ours of smaller providers, that's oftentimes what we try to do. We need people from both sides to work and to come together to solve problems so that we can then implement. What do you think by way of, you know, any possibility for new broadband legislation that maybe could address some of these issues, pave the way for your initiative, et cetera? You think there's any chances for that happening short term? And, you know, has anything changed perhaps in light of the COVID-19 crisis? And Blair, I'll direct that to you.
You know, it was interesting at the beginning of this, there was a question of whether we would start to all agree. We're all in the same boat here. We ought to work together. You know, I'm not sure that's happening. Though, interestingly, it did happen for a little while in Congress. When you look at some polling, I think it's happening. But on the question of net neutrality, I don't think so. Look, I think there's actually a consensus that the three fundamental rules should be no blocking, no throttling, no unreasonable paid prioritization. The problem is, I think, for the Republicans, they're comfortable with the more kind of deregulatory message. And I think for the Democrats, they want to have a safety valve, which is keeping the cop on the street. And this is the general conduct rule that Chairman Wheeler put into place. And I just think that's a divide that's really hard. There's actually a very legitimate philosophical disagreement about, do you need to have the rules all stated up front, or do you need to have some general authority, kind of like the Sherman Act, that kind of creates a vague notion of what the harm is. Having said that, I'm not really sure that the debate has influenced that much from a Wall Street perspective. I mean, there was a lot of deployment between 2010 and 2018 when the new rules were essentially adopted. That's when the speeds really increased. And I will say there have been a couple of incidents, like in Santa Barbara with the California fires, where one could point to the lack of Title II as maybe having something to do with it, though maybe not, you know. So I think it's an important debate. I have my own views on it, but I don't think Congress is going to pass anything soon. On the other hand, I hope that we figure out what is it we need to do to make, you know, we've had a generation of kids really lose a lot of education. How can we make that up to them? And I think the tools of technology can do that in a variety of different ways, but we're not doing that yet. And so, you know, that I hope we figure out how to focus on those things that really improve outcomes.
Well, couldn't agree with you more. And as I said, our organization's been very supportive of working together with groups to find a solution along those bright line principles and protecting consumers, as well as, you know, working together to allow investment that gives consumers more of what they want. So we're certainly on board with that. Well, our time is about over. This hour has flown by, but I do have one last question for you both, as well as to just thank you. And while we've talked about, you know, kind of looking a little bit before the crisis and how we've all performed during the crisis and maybe a little bit ahead, let's talk beyond, because truly, as we said here, you know, this broadband infrastructure is going to be central to consumers, to businesses, to our economy, to the world, really. And we're the providers of that, working, you know, with our customers. So what do you think the broadband and digital infrastructure agenda to really drive economic growth that will help us out of this crisis, what do you think that should be to not only drive that economic growth, but also social progress over the next decade? And Larry, I'll start with you.
Wow, that's really broad. Look, I mean, the short answer is more, and maybe faster. We know, you know, it's clear that, you know, the last couple of years, as Blair hinted at, there's been this backlash against tech. I think it was more sort of faddish than anything else. And you know, it went to the wayside immediately when we suddenly all had to be at home and doing everything from the computer. Now, some of it's already starting to come back, particularly as we suggested on the privacy and the security concerns, which are legitimate, although I think largely overblown for various different reasons. But there's no doubt that these trends, again, all they did is accelerate. We're just going to use it. We're going to use it all that we were ever going to use it for, just faster and sooner. And so more investment in, obviously, in infrastructure is going to be key. Also in the infrastructure of the software. So the cloud becomes even more important. Edge computing becomes even more important. The integration of mobile and physical networking becomes even more important. And, you know, where 5G will fit in to that, and also the backbone in terms of covering and carrying all that traffic, all the mobility things. This is just going to go faster, and we're just going to need more of it sooner. In some ways, it's great news for your members. That means the investments that they're making are going to perhaps pay off sooner, but it's also the other end of the spectrum is you now have to do more of it, and you have to even invest even further ahead. If you're an infrastructure provider, if you're an ISP, where, as I said at the beginning, we have the least investment is at the industry level at applications. By industries, I mean, you know, financial services and energy and public education and so on. Those applications need to happen. And of course, it's a lovely virtuous circle. If we had more government services online, in one way, that would help to close the adoption problem. Because as Blair and I wrote in a piece some years ago, if the services you absolutely need, and now they become even more essential if you're unemployed and suddenly things are not so clear on the job market or the economy, if all the government services that you're entitled to are available and easy to use online, this is one really powerful technique for closing the adoption gap. Say, look, you didn't think it was relevant. You didn't think there was anything there for you. Suddenly it becomes life or death. So I think, you know, from the standpoint of infrastructure providers, more, faster. From the standpoint of applications and industries, including government, it's, get your act together and stop this process of systematically underinvesting.
Good advice. Blair, the next 10 years.
Number one, finish the job of getting networks everywhere. I think it will cost less than people think. And while we're spending $1 trillion here and $1 trillion there, there's a few tens of billions of dollars that could be easily used to finish that job. Number two, get everybody on. That's a more complicated problem, as Larry said earlier, but it's again a solvable problem. And I think the payback to society is very significant. And then third, take a look at the last half of the National Broadband Plan, the so-called national purposes, and rewrite the hell out of it. The opportunity is greater. The upside is greater, but we really need to rethink how we deliver public goods and services. There's a lot of good stuff there, but there's better stuff to be done, no doubt.
Well, the name of the article is The Internet After COVID-19, Will We Mind the Gaps? Gentlemen, thank you so much for your thoughtfulness, for the time that you've spent in really looking at these issues, and really giving us some encouragement with some credible and very concrete ideas on how, again, we can try to find ways to work together to solve these internet issues. So thank you so much for being with us here today at ACA
Connect. Thank you, Matt.
Thank you, Matt.
And let me also say thank you to our ACA Connect's own Ross Lieberman for helping me in the production of this, as well as the planning, and our own Tamika Slappy, who's helped me with all of the technical stuff, of which I am certainly not the guru. So it's great to be here with you again at ACA Connect. And please let us know if we can help you in any way. You can reach out to us at our website, acaconnects.org. And please let us know how we can help you, because we're here to serve. Thanks a lot, everybody. We'll see you soon.